terrific to get started in the new year with such a wonderful guest who will be introduced by Bill in a moment. But just to give you some highlights on some upcoming events to mark in your calendar, and I'll look just to be certain to get the dates right. On the 24th, Zbigniew Brzezinski and Mika Brzezinski will be at the Common Good, which we've been looking forward to for quite some time. We have Ambassador Mansour on the 30th of January, author Jill Eiskel on February 8th, and Howard Dean on the 17th. And that calendar will be supplemented as events pop up, so watch your emails. And with no further ado, Bill Hubbard will have the honor of introducing today's guest. And Bob Peters, here he is. We decided to get started given people's time schedules, so, but we want to thank our host for sure, Bob Peters after, so thank you yet again, Bob. Bill?
I am really, I'm honored to be introducing our speaker today because I was brought up, like many of you, I think, in the, or I was in college in the 60s, and I remember after graduating, I went to graduate school for a year in London. I went to law school for 3 years, which I couldn't stand, and then I was in the VISTA program, and then I got married. And this was all to avoid going to Vietnam, all to avoid going to Vietnam. And the Bible, after, during that period and after, as many of you remember, was sideshow, and I never thought in my life that I'd ever meet and have breakfast with the author of that book, which was really one of the definitive works of that period, and really exposed all of a lot of terrible things that were going on in the government, which I almost feel like, and I'm sure many of you do, we've just repeated in the last 8 years, in the whole Iraq-Afghanistan experience. So, I don't know, I have not read Justice and the Enemy. I will be reading it, and I hope it's as spellbinding as Sideshow was back several decades ago. Won't say how many. So, having said that, I'd like to introduce our speaker.
It's an honor to be here, and thank you all, especially Patricia, who originally invited me here, I think. And I'm very pleased. Sideshow was published in 1979, and it was rather a notorious book. The subtitle of it was Kissinger, Nixon, and the Destruction of Cambodia. And it was a rather aggressive attack, particularly on Henry Kissinger, who took a slightly dim view of it. Though I have to say, he's got a great sense of humor, Kissinger. I saw him, I do occasionally see him now, though he denounced or had his aides denounce the book in no uncertain terms when it came out. But recently I saw him at an event in London, and he came up and spoke to me. Then his wife went striding past, and he said, Mr. Shawcross, you see, for me it's the 30 years war, but for Nancy, it'll always be the 100 years war. So, that was extremely elegant. And in fact, I became friends about 6 years ago with the man on his staff who denounced me at the time of Sideshow, who wrote a long attack on me in the American Spectator. Anyway, things go round, and Kissinger is much more. Well, as I say, he's a man of great wit, if nothing else, and well, he's a brilliant man, too. Anyhow, this book is very different. At the end of Sideshow, I said that the story of Cambodia and the misuse of government power showed how the world's governance of the world's most vital democracy was corrupted by Nixon and Kissinger, and the Cambodian secret bombing and so on was very much the foreign policy side of Watergate. And this book continues that theme of America being the world's most vital democracy, which is something I believe very strongly. And I think that without the United States, we in Europe would be completely lost. And I believe, which I'm, unfortunately, I think your President Obama does not believe in strongly as I would like to, him to do, in the idea of American exceptionalism. I'd like to read you, to begin with, a quote from the French philosopher Pascal Bruckner, who wrote, "The perpetual peace to which Europe aspires has its source not in Europe, but in the United States. If America were to collapse tomorrow, Europe would fall like a house of cards. It would return to the turgiversation it showed in Munich in 1938 and be reduced to a deluxe sanatorium, ready to allow itself to be torn apart piece by piece by all sorts of predators." We're actually seeing in Europe now that, I hope not the beginnings of that, but we are seeing the collapse of the European Union's utopianism, which was, I think, most recklessly expressed in the decision to create the euro, a common currency binding Germany and Greece at its greatest extremes. And we still don't know how that's going to work out, but it's going to be a very messy and difficult process. In Greece now, already the anti-German feeling is extremely bitter, and you have Germans being burnt in effigies of Nazis being burnt in the squares in Athens. And it's spreading throughout southern Europe. I noticed in the paper this morning that the Prime Minister, the President, imposed on Italy, Mario Monti, is himself saying that austerity imposed by Germany and the richer Euro nation create very serious social unrest within Italy, and that the same is happening in Spain. So I think Europe, the demons of Europe are unfortunately not quelled by the European Union. If anything, the Euro experiment, which is failing fast, may rejuvenate them. Anyway, that is not the subject of the book. The subject of this book is begins in Nuremberg and ends in Guantanamo. And it begins in Nuremberg because my father was the chief British prosecutor, along with Justice Robert Jackson, the American prosecutor, who became a good friend of his and was a very fine and magnificent jurist. And I used to listen in the 50s to 78 RPM recordings of my father's speeches at Nuremberg, which recounted some of the evidence, his opening and closing speeches for the prosecution of the Nazi atrocities throughout Europe. And I remember in particular one speech, that he quoted a German engineer who had visited a mass grave in the Ukraine where SS troops were herding Jewish families, naked Jewish families, into mass graves and shooting them. And it was all in the first person because my father was quoting this engineer, and I could never understand how he could have seen such appalling things until I realized later, or he explained to me, that he was quoting from a German engineer. And years later in Cambodia, which is, as you said, the subject of my book Sideshow, after the end of the Khmer Rouge period, of atrocious misrule in 1979, I went to Cambodia and saw similar mass graves that Khmer Rouge had filled with innocent Cambodians, which was a terrible, shocking thing to see, that the mass graves, the sort of one of the awful features of the 20th century, should have been perpetuated decades after the Second World War. And looking at the lessons of Nuremberg and what is happening now in the United States and the way in which the United States has tried fitfully to deal with the consequences of the appalling attacks on 9/11. I've tried in this book to show what, if any, relevance Nuremberg has. And Barack Obama, during his Senate career and his 2008 campaign, was extremely critical of the Bush administration on almost every aspect of its war on terror policies. And in one of his campaign speeches, he evoked the memories of Nuremberg and said that Nuremberg was an example to us all. It, despite the appalling atrocities committed by the Nazis, they were given their day in court. And it's true, and I think Nuremberg was indeed a success. It's sometimes still dismissed as a victor's justice. I think that's unfair and improper. Of the 20 defendants in the dock at Nuremberg, I think 12 were convicted and sentenced to death. Six were sentenced to long terms of imprisonment, from which they all, almost all, I think, emerged at the end, and two were released, were discharged. And so I think justice was done at Nuremberg, and it was a singular achievement, and it was extraordinary because it happened so quickly and so efficiently. The war ended in May 1945, or the war in Europe did, and Roosevelt and afterwards Truman appointed Justice Jackson at the same time, just before the end of the war, to be the chief prosecutor. At that time, the Russians wanted to just execute 100,000 German officers. Churchill thought that summary execution of the 10 leaders captured would be the right way to go. He didn't want a trial to begin with. The United States insisted on a trial, quite rightly. And Jackson went off to Europe, and with the tour, the wreckage of Europe in the summer of 1945, and astonishingly, the United States had collected, principally the United States, collected enough evidence in Paris and all the German war crimes, and because the Germans kept extensive bureaucratic notes, documentation, and these were all gathered in Paris, and the trial opened a few months later in November 1945, which is an amazing achievement considering the slowness that most judicial proceedings take these days. If you look at the International Criminal Court, for example, it's a snail compared to the process at Nuremberg. And the trial ended in July 1946, and the sentences were pronounced in October 1946 and carried out in November 1946. And then lesser trials went on for the next 3 or 4 years. But I think Nuremberg was a great achievement. But I think, and so Obama was quite right to refer to that. On the other hand, he held up Nuremberg as an example of a much better system than the military commissions which had been passed by the 2006 Act of Congress here in the United States during the Bush administration. And actually, that was unfair. And it's, I think, important to note that if any Nazi in the dock at Nuremberg were transported by time machine to Guantanamo, he would be astonished and delighted by the extent of the privileges accorded him by not only the 2006 Military Commissions Act, but even more so the 2009 Military Commissions Act, which was passed in the Obama administration, obviously, which gives further safeguards. And the basic thing is that, whereas at Nuremberg there was no right of appeal whatsoever, the judgment of the tribunal was final, here at Guantanamo, anyone convicted can appeal all the way through the federal process up to the Supreme Court. So anyone can. If Khalid Sheikh Mohammed is convicted of first-degree murder in Guantanamo, his lawyers can and probably will take the whole issue to the Supreme Court. So the ultimate safeguard exists for anyone in Guantanamo, as it does anyone who was tried in Manhattan. And this book came about because when Eric Holder announced in November 2009 that he was going to put Khalid Sheikh Mohammed on trial in Manhattan, as you recall better than I, being denizens of Manhattan, there was an immediate row and a question mark as to whether this was actually the best way to deal with the problem. And my wonderful publishers, Public Affairs, Peter Osmus, who's an old friend from Vietnam days, called me up and said, William, your father was the British prosecutor at Nuremberg, so why didn't you write a short, sharp book saying Nuremberg was how we dealt with the monsters then, here's how we should deal with it then today. So I said blithely, because I loved my father and admired him, I thought it would be nice to write a bit about him, I blithely said yes and thought I would finish it a year ago, and in fact it took much longer because it's a much more complicated subject than I had understood. Anyway, the trial at Guantanamo probably will begin in March, because Obama, having said in 2009 no military trials, Guantanamo will be closed, has had to accept the realities of the situation and in effect has adopted most of President Bush's policies in the war on terror. And the trial at Guantanamo stays open because there are still 172 people there, I think, who nobody wishes to take, and they can't be found safe places to go to. And some of them don't actually wish to leave. And so Guantanamo is open, and the military commissions process has been revived in the 2009 Act. And I have, one of the purposes of this book is to show that the very bad press that the United States has got, particularly in Europe, I think is improper and wrong. Of course, the United States has made mistakes since 9/11. Any country would have done, any president would have done. Churchill famously said, war is a catalogue of blunders. And there's no doubt there have been blunders made in this war by the United States, and it was a very, very difficult situation to deal with. And I think one should remember, in criticizing the administration's reaction after 9/11, that the great fear was that Al-Qaeda was attempting to arm itself with weapons of mass destruction. Bin Laden had said time and time again, this is our aim, to acquire and use weapons of mass destruction against the infidel enemy. And I think any administration of 2001. Now, the trial will begin, as I say, and there is a very, very able chief prosecutor, the direct successor of Robert Jackson, who's called General Mark Martins. And he's an infantryman and a military lawyer, and he was most recently spent several years in Afghanistan trying to establish rule of law in the Afghan countryside, which he thinks he's done well, but I suspect it may all be swept away once the United States and the British and others depart in 2014, sadly. But he's a very fine officer, and if you want to read what he says about his role, he gave two very good speeches recently, one to the American Bar Association here in New York in December, and one 2 days ago, which I attended, to the New York Bar Association. And he has made it explicit that he sees his task not to replace or supplant the federal courts, but to complement them. He thinks that most terrorists put on trial will still be tried in the federal system. And a few cases, and it's quite hard to define which, I think, will go to Guantanamo, principally the Khalid Sheikh Mohammed case. And he has made it clear, and this is his speech, and this is one of the things that worried me. He made it clear in this speech 2 days ago. Under the 2009 Act, no statement obtained through the use of torture or cruel, inhuman, or degrading treatment is admissible into evidence in a military commission. And further, and this is one of its most significant reforms, the 2009 Act requires that before any statement of the accused may be admitted, a military judge must find the statement to be reliable, probative, and voluntary under a totality of the circumstances test. I think the procedures that have been put in place in 2009, as I said before, are far more generous to the defendants than in Nuremberg, which I think was not a show trial, was a proper trial. But nonetheless, the defendants now have many, many more rights. And I think that although there will be predictable outrage in Europe about the use of military commissions, I think that all the safeguards necessary for fair trials are in place. And I think General Martins is someone who will become much more of a public figure as the successor to Justice Jackson, the real direct successor, and I hope that he gets proper support and not abuse, because I think that's what he deserves.
Karen Gant, and I was really looking forward to reading your book. I wondered if you could tell us a little about your father's relationship with Winston Churchill.
Well, my father, like every other British person practically, was a great admirer of Churchill. They were on opposite sides of the House because my father was elected to the Labour government in 1945 in a landslide which threw Churchill out to his astonishment and regret after the end of the war. And my father was probably the most senior lawyer, though he was only 42 at the time, and therefore he was made Attorney General. But he became disillusioned with the Labour Party in the 1950s and resigned from it and resigned from Parliament and became a close friend of Churchill in the 1950s and a sort of unofficial legal advisor to him. But I remember when I was a child in December, I don't know, probably about 1953, when Churchill had been re-elected, we always had an annual expedition to the circus. And my father said to me, I'm going to Downing Street to the Prime Minister. Do you want to stay here and see the elephants, or would you rather see the Prime Minister? I'm glad to say I made the right choice.
My question.
Yeah.
Thank you. My question was, you mentioned that any information or testimony or confession that was acquired by the use of torture wouldn't be admissible in Guantanamo. Given what you know about the environment and the treatment of the inmates at Guantanamo, the detainees at Guantanamo, would you say that there's been extensive use of what we would refer to as torture and therefore make the confessions or the information inadmissible? Or has it been relatively acceptable behavior and therefore the trials will proceed and evidence will be presented on and the confessions will be considered valid?
Three people were waterboarded, amongst them Khalid Sheikh Mohammed. And in Europe, it's believed that hundreds of people were waterboarded. It's not true. Three were waterboarded, and about 28 were subjected to other forms of so-called enhanced interrogation in the early days after 9/11. So it was not as extensive as the propaganda against the United States believes or proposes, pretends. The conditions in Guantanamo have improved enormously since 2001. A Belgian judge from a European fact-finding delegation, the deputy head of the Belgian prison system went there in 2005 and said this prison is far better than anything we have in Belgium. Muslim prisoners here in Guantanamo are treated far more humanely and with all their Muslim religious rights observed than we can do in Belgium. That, of course, is not the perception in the world. Guantanamo is clearly a tragedy for the United States and for the innocent people who were originally rounded up there. It's an incredibly difficult thing to know what would have been better in the aftermath of the invasion of the overthrow of the Taliban in Afghanistan. The United States, very lightly armed force, rounded up thousands of Al-Qaeda and Taliban fighters, tried to corral them within Afghanistan and found it impossible to control them because unlike prisoners of war in the 1939-45 war, they didn't consider that their war was over. They continued fighting. And the first person American killed in the war on terror was a CIA agent called officer called Johnny Spann, who was overwhelmed in a fort in Afghanistan in November 2001, I think, when Arab prisoners managed to arm themselves and stage a rebellion. And Tommy Franks, General Tommy Franks, said, we've got to get these people out of here. And the question was, where was the administration going to put them? And they decided on Guantanamo for legal reasons, because it's offshore and outside the federal justice system, which was why President Clinton had used it for Haitian and Cuban people during his administration. But it's a very difficult problem. Guantanamo was abhorrent to Obama. He said he would close it. He's failed to do so because, as I said, it's very hard to get rid of the hardcore prisoners there. And what I've tried to look at in this book is the dilemma of the lesser evil. And Michael Walzer, the American philosopher, wrote very movingly and has written very movingly throughout his career of that dilemma. And he said, I can find it, which I probably can't. The politician who decides that he must, in the interests of his own people, torture, is cursed. It may be a decision that he makes in good faith, but he will be cursed with that decision for the rest of his life. And in a way, that happens to, here we are, his choices are hard and painful, and he pays a price not only while making them, but forever after. And in a way, I think America has paid a terrible price for those decisions also. The head of MI5, Eliza Manningham Buller, the British Secret Service, said in a series of radio broadcasts, the Reith Lectures, which is the BBC's principal sort of intellectual broadcast of the year, if you like, essays of the year, she said, she criticized very strongly waterboarding and other aggressive interrogation. And she said, the argument that life-saving intelligence was thereby obtained, and I accept it was, which is, I think, crucial, still does not justify it. So again, I think it's the dilemma of the lesser evil. Other people would say that life-saving evidence was obtained by waterboarding, therefore it is justified, and that in terms of the way of aggressive interrogation, it's not that bad. That's one of the arguments I've tried to look at in this book. And Bush was excoriated and is still excoriated for waterboarding three people. And it's bizarre in a way, or interesting, I think, it's another thing, that although Obama said there's absolutely no way that this can continue, He has used a much more aggressive form, if you like, of action against suspected terrorists. He's killed them by drones. The drone program under the Bush administration was relatively restrained, as perhaps relatively small. Obama has expanded it. And instead of capturing prisoners, suspects, and interrogating them, they have been killed. And over 1,200 people have been killed in Pakistan, Afghanistan, Somalia, and Yemen by drone attacks. Now, I'm quite sure that most of those people were identified with as people plotting terrorism plots against the United States or Europe. And one, there was a big spike of drone attacks in Pakistan in autumn and fall of 2010, when apparently there was evidence that they were planning a Mumbai-style attack on a major European city. Once again, the United States comes to the aid of its European allies, for which it doesn't often get very much thanks, and a lot of terrorist suspects were killed in those drone attacks. And what is interesting to me, and I've tried to explore this, is that Obama has had very, very little criticism of this until recently, until the last few months. And it's a huge expansion of a program that organizations like the ACLU and the Center for Constitutional Rights denounce as extrajudicial murder. And now, Obama will find it much more difficult, I think, and to carry on with it. But what is interesting about it is that whereas waterboarding is aggressive interrogation, this is termination with extreme prejudice, as they used to say in Vietnam. So I've tried to look at this again, the nature of the problems of the lesser evils.
What is your understanding, because I suspect you've studied this a lot more than the rest of us have, as to what aggressive interrogation techniques have actually achieved for us in terms of safety, in terms of saving lives, one, and two, as to what extent aggressive interrogation techniques are necessary to achieving convictions in the judicial context. To what extent do confessions and other things, are they necessary to getting convictions of these people? Or do we already really have enough? Haven't they effectively already admitted their acts? And the reason I ask the second part of that is because talking about the dilemma between evils, or perhaps the dilemma between goods, it strikes me that given in accepting American exceptionalism and the high principles that we hold out to the world, we don't really need these aggressive interrogation techniques and their fruit to achieve these convictions. Isn't it better that we hold out the principles of not using these kinds of aggressive techniques and keep these things out if we can do that?
Yeah, well, in answer quickly to your second question, yes, of course it's better that there's you stand by American principles. And I think, as I say, that they were used sparingly after 9/11, and they probably should not have been used at all. But it is an interesting contrast that people, America is denounced for aggressive interrogation, but not denounced yet for the explosion of drone, expansion of drone killings. And I think that's an interesting contrast, one which I've tried to explore, and I don't have an answer to it. In answer to your first question, what did we gain from aggressive interrogations? That is very much a matter of dispute still. As I mentioned, I quoted Eliza Manningham Bullard, who said that we did gain life-saving information, but nonetheless we shouldn't have done it. That's a pretty, she's taking a very strong line on that, on one side of the argument. After Obama came into office and released the Justice Department memos which justified aggressive interrogation and said it was legal, and the Justice Department began investigation of the lawyers who had written these memos, John Yoo and others, Vice President Cheney demanded that the White House also release the CIA memoranda which showed exactly what information was derived from aggressive interrogation, and the White House refused to do that. Cheney said masses of life-saving information was deduced from those interrogations. And after the killing of Bin Laden last May, several senior former retired officials insisted, and I think actually Leon Panetta agreed with it, that part of the trail leading to bin Laden eventually had been found through the interrogation of those original Khalid Sheikh Mohammed and other people who were aggressively interrogated. But we don't know the full answer to it yet. I'm sure we will know one day. But you're absolutely right, aggressive interrogation is to be avoided. But as I say, torture, sometimes, to say torture doesn't work isn't correct, I don't think it's always true. It doesn't always work, but sometimes it does work. And the politician may sometimes feel it is essential, but as I say, as Michael Walsh has said so eloquently, he will carry the cost of that for the rest of his life.
Before that answer, I had only one question, but now I have two. My initial question is about the impact on the First Amendment of not having a public trial. I'm a reporter, so I have a vested interest in being in court, and I'm wondering whether it's your view that not conducting this as an ordinary trial is overriding the principles of the United States and open proceedings. The question that I came up with what you were just talking is it not true that the purpose of this interrogation was, unlike almost any other criminal case, not to gather evidence that would be sufficient to stand up in court to prosecute the person, but in fact to unearth co-conspirators?
To do what?
Unearth co-conspirators and plots.
Yes. Yeah.
And so, therefore, it really wasn't a judicial interrogation in any way.
That is absolutely true. It wasn't, because they were desperate to find intelligence. They knew so little about Al-Qaeda on 9/11, and they were desperate to learn much, much more. And as I said before, there was this terror of WMD, which is an understandable fear, given that Bin Laden advertised his desire to acquire such weapons. So that it was an intelligent, it was an inquiry, an aggressive inquiry. It's nothing to do with judicial findings at that stage. And all the evidence that was uncovered, all the confessions that were uncovered through aggressive interrogation will be disallowed in the court in Guantanamo, as they are in federal courts. But it won't be a closed trial. It will be an open trial. There will be 60 or 80 people in the courtroom, victims, families, and reporters, and human rights organizations. And for those who don't wish to go and live in Guantanamo for a very long time, which is obviously not very comfortable, there will be video feeds to Fort Meade and other places through the United States, so that, again, victims, families, and the press can attend and see the trials in real time. It's not a closed trial.
But do you think this fear of the defendants and their associates is justified?
Fear of them in what sense?
Not holding a trial in New York City. I mean, the mayor saying, oh, we shouldn't do this.
Well, that's a different issue. That's a political decision from the mayor. I mean, I think the fear of disruption and the fear of Al-Qaeda attack, which I think is probably much diminished by the fact that Al-Qaeda Central has been so badly decimated, if not destroyed, in the last few years. But there's another interesting and rather horrible aspect to the fear of the defendants. General Martins was saying the other day that I think in one case that 600,000 pages of discovery have already been amassed, which will be turned over to the defendants' lawyers and to the defendants themselves if they wish to have it. And some of the defendants may wish to defend themselves and not to be represented. But of these 600,000 pages, he said one of the things we have to do is to take out every single paperclip on every single staple for fear that they may manufacture weapons from these everyday artifacts. There was a horrible case here in New York Penitentiary in the year 2000, where a prisoner who called Salim, who had been involved in the embassy bombings in 1998 and been convicted of his role in that, fashioned a plastic comb into a sharp dagger, a one tooth of the comb, and stabbed a warder in the eye, Officer Pepe, who was not only blinded in that eye, but brain damaged. And his life has been completely ruined. So these people remain threats, and it's very, officials need to be protected from them to that degree. So the idea of, thinking of having to take paper clips and staples out of 600,000 pieces of paper is quite an ordeal in itself.
My question is, the apparent objective from Capture to Kill through the program. Do you think that's related to the nightmare, this whole criminal process, the numbers that it creates and conflicts it creates?
I think Obama didn't want to be faced with the dilemmas that the Bush administration was faced with of interrogation and capture and interrogation, and almost no one has been taken, captured. Al-Qaeda or Taliban suspects have been taken. No one's been taken to Guantanamo. Though, to be fair, I don't think anybody was taken in the last 2 years of the Bush administration to Guantanamo either. But no one's also, either, very few people have been taken to Bagram in Afghanistan either. So there is no question but that the Obama administration, by using drones rather than capture and interrogation, has lost and potentially lost a lot of intelligence that would have been useful to it. So the answer to your question is yes, and that is a very important side effect of the policy. But I'm sure, on the other hand, I think it's clear that drones have killed people who were embarking and planning to embark on major operations like Mumbai, possibly in Europe and elsewhere, so there's no question but that policy has saved lives, but it comes at a cost.
Comment and a question. Comment is this, apropos the gentleman's question about judicial proceedings as opposed to the necessity of getting information. Alan Dershowitz, liberal democratic attorney, trial attorney from Harvard, he couched it in the following, that if there's a ticking time bomb, that's the one place where you could use enhanced interrogation. Question is this. Rules of evidence. Military tribunals in our history have been, all presidents engaged in any conflagration have been very much involved in military tribunals and commissions. Whether it was Washington or Lincoln, which you may not know, had 2,200 military commissions and tribunals. 50% of them were in states that weren't even secessionists. Anyway, point being is on the rules of evidence, in our civil court, we do not allow, in our federal courts, hearsay evidence. Hearsay evidence in a military tribunal can be very important, i.e., if Khalid Sheikh Mohammed told his mother what he was about to do, that would be evidence. If his mother then told her best girlfriend, that would not be admissible in our federal court. So my question then to you is, how is that procedure? Have you looked at it enough? Because when you talk about Nuremberg, in my opinion, that was a military tribunal. It was not
yes,
a civil.
It wasn't. Yes.
It was not civil. And therefore, do you think that by changing, you mentioned the 06-09 Act, do you think that the rules of evidence are such that perhaps non-American citizens are getting more of a benefit out of this trial system than they would have under some of the Nuremberg rules?
Oh yeah, they're getting, I'm sorry I didn't make myself clear, they're getting far more benefit of US law, far more protections than the Nazis got in Nuremberg.
What I meant in general, not just them, but I just used the Nuremberg, you mentioned that up through now. In other words, there is nothing, as I see, wrong with taking foreigners, putting them in to a military setting. And I'm worried that what you're talking about that's going on in Guantanamo with Khalid Sheikh Mohammed is a quasi-military civil proceeding.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it is. It's, I mean, there will be defense, military defense lawyers and civilian defense lawyers involved to go up as well, and human rights organizations. So it will be, but it's a military proceeding, but it has practically all the protections of a federal court. The only thing that is slightly different is, as you say, hearsay. Some hearsay evidence is allowed under some circumstances to be strictly defined by the judge, and no doubt challenged by the defense lawyers. And the military defense lawyers in previous cases since 9/11 have been very aggressive on behalf of their clients, and they've taken some cases like the Hamdan versus Rumsfeld case to the Supreme Court and won important victories against the government. So I think these people will be very, very skillfully and aggressively defended. The other big difference that is that the Miranda rule is not applied in military courts. No, anybody, a soldier arresting somebody on the battlefield does not have to read any Miranda rights, which of course is important in a federal court. There was a very interesting example of the problems of a federal court. Last year, there was a trial of someone called Gailani, Tanzanian Muslim, who'd been involved in the embassy bombings in which 200 people were killed in 1998, and most of them Africans, most of them Muslim Africans. And he was arrested, and he had been aggressively interrogated, and he came to the federal court, and it was a complicated process, and the judge, Judge Kaplan, said, the fruits of the poisonous tree, i.e. aggressive interrogation, will not appear in this court. None of that evidence is valid. There was a lot of evidence to show that he was deeply involved in the plot to bomb the embassies, but some of it was disallowed because, for example, the man who'd stolen the truck that was used in the Tanzanian bombing, that his name had come forward by second or third hearsay procedures after aggressive interrogation of someone else. So his name wasn't allowed, and so that evidence was him saying, I shall, this guy lying that Trump is not allowed to be heard. In the end, there was what one of those famous rogue jurors who wanted to acquit Gailani on all charges, and the compromise reached on the within the jury was that he would be convicted, but only of conspiracy to damage government buildings. So that was the issue on which he was convicted, which was obviously very disappointing, to say the least, to the families of the victims. And frankly, it's sort of travesty that he murdered 220 people and was convicted of conspiracy to damage government buildings. But that was, I mean, he was at least convicted, and Judge Kaplan took a month off to decide what the sentence should be and threw the book at him and gave him 30 years, I think, and life. But that was a problem of a federal trial. But similar problems may arise in the military trial. It's not going to be a foregone conclusion that the trial in Guantanamo. And who knows whether KSM, who is a great buffoon grandstander, will not try and take over the court defending himself, or he may say, I'm guilty, I did all this, and I'm proud of it, I want to be martyred, I want to be put in the electric chair right away. Whatever. It's all open. No one knows what's going to happen. But my point is that I think that the United States can be confident that it will be done with the greatest regard under the direction of General Martins to every aspect of proper law.
Thank you so much. Will everybody please help? Thank you. This very thorny issue of how we try these terrible acts. Please know that we have books of Mr. Shawcross's here. He will sign them, so please buy one and bring them to us. We will get them signed right now. And I want to thank our host again, Robert Peterzak, for making this event possible. I also want to thank our staff, Jen and Isabel, who's outside for a moment, Erica, Amanda, Alexis. You guys have all done a great job. And please come to our next event with Zbigniew Brzezinski. Mika Brzezinski, his daughter, will be introducing him on the 24th for lunch. And we've got a few other wonderful events coming up, so we hope we'll see you all very soon. Thank you so much. Thank you.